Hi, Caroline. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you? Happy Monday.
Happy Monday. Happy Red Day.
Yeah, it's our first day in the red zone, so that means we're not 100% on lockdown, but it means our kids can't go to school. Most kids can't go to school, including elementary. So this is our first day of trying to have two people on a video call at once. So that's what's going on at my house. What about
Yeah,
you?
it seems like Groundhog Day, like a year ago. It was a year ago.
Yeah,
So,
all over again, huh?
yeah, all over again. Well, it's also, besides lockdown, red zone for our area. Luna Rosa lost last night. They lost two.
No,
So now it's 5-3.
5-3.
We're
Okay,
talking about
so
the America's Cup in New Zealand. I don't know what happened. I didn't hear the whole story. I think they got into an area where there was no wind. And, like, I don't know. They
well, those
were 2 kilometers
boats,
behind.
okay, because the boats work really, really well with low wind, but in no wind, they don't do as well, I suppose. But I know they had to postpone the race because there was no wind.
No wind, yes.
So yesterday they didn't race. Then they raced what would have been Monday, so during the night for us.
They're
So I was
going to race
hoping
again
we would.
tonight.
Okay,
And if
perfect.
we lose two, it's over because you need to win seven.
Okay, well, we'll have to check.
No.
But I think already, you know, the fact that I think the Luna Rosa team should be really proud of themselves anyway,
Yeah.
because they're going against the people who are, you know, had the cup last time. So anything you do is already going to be pretty exciting. And they've been holding their own, I think.
Well,
So
it would be
I
nice
don't
if they
know.
would come to Italy once. I don't think it's ever
Yes,
been
that
in
would be.
Italy. That would be cool. And
You
plus, there are
think?
three people on the team from here.
I know.
So, yeah, that's
So.
incredible.
Cross our
Anyway,
fingers. Cross
oh
our
well.
fingers, because that's a
Maybe
bug I would
we'll
like to
have
have up there.
America's Cup in Trieste
Wouldn't that
since
be
we have
fun?
like a majority of the team members are from Trieste.
Well, and it's a big sailing town. Trieste is a total sailing town. I think that, you know, it would be the perfect place to have the America's Cup. But that's
Well,
just
I
me.
saw on, they showed it on TV the day that there was no wind. They had 2,000 boats out watching the race.
Wow.
So it was like a Barcalana, basically.
Right. Which is our big
Everybody
sailing
just out there
place.
having a party.
Like
Oh, well.
tailgating on the water,
Tailgating
right?
on it. Yeah, it's a good place to tailgate.
I love it.
Well,
So,
yesterday was Pi Day.
yeah, I know our friend Domenico actually made a strawberry pie. It was a cheesecake with a pie symbol in the middle with strawberries around it.
That
So
looked delicious.
it did
I'll
look
post a
good.
picture of his pie later.
Yeah, you have to.
He could have won our pie contest the other year. I found those
He
pictures from
could have.
2019 when we did our own pie cook-off.
That was fun. Yeah, that was
Yeah.
one of our better cook-offs. Yeah, I miss those. The simple things that we can't do anymore right now, right?
What were we going to do this year or last year if we did a cook-off? I can't remember. I don't
I can't remember
remember.
either.
Cake, maybe.
No, was it a
Yeah.
dessert? No, it was going to be cheesecake, wasn't it?
Cheesecake, right. Right,
So,
right,
like,
right.
specifically cheesecake. Because
Yeah.
you know, we only do stuff we like, so.
This is true.
Right.
Before it's diet time. Because now that we're back in lockdown, I was thinking I'm gonna get out, well, I got out the stationary bike again.
Oh, well done.
Yeah, so that nobody will recognize me when we get out of here. I hope it's
Well,
soon, but
I don't have an exercise bike, but I did find my jump rope.
okay,
So
that'll
I'm gonna
do.
jump rope in my courtyard, and you're gonna ride your stationary
I'll ride my
bike.
bike while I read my book club book.
Yeah, people aren't going to recognize us when we're
They
done
won't
with the
recognize
countdown.
us. Well, I was smart this time because I went and I got my hair cut Thursday before everything closed.
Apparently, they're open even on Sundays this time
Well,
because
they
all the
were open
hairdressers,
yesterday,
yeah, the
yeah.
hairdressers had to close. What else is closed for the red zone? Like restaurants?
I think it's basically like last year, but there's some strange things that are open, like stores that sell underwear, Intimo. Why is that essential? I don't know.
Aren't
I
they
mean, I got a
essential
whole
for
drawer full
you?
of stuff. I don't
I don't
know.
know.
I don't know. And stuff for kids, children's clothes, toy stores are open. I don't think they were open last year. And sporting stores are open. I don't know why. So what does that mean?
I don't know. It makes you wonder if there's some sort of like secret lobbying going on.
Yes.
Do the Intimo people have like secret lobbyists going down to Rome? And
my
like,
husband said that could be very helpful.
Right.
Like, right. The Intimo. I'm going to go out and buy fancy stuff.
Fancy.
Oh, well. Okay. Oh, well.
All right. So what else is buzzing this week? I heard people are asking about what we think about the Amanda Gorman translation debacle.
Yes.
You heard about that.
Yeah, okay, I heard about that, but that sounds very strange to me. I don't think it was Amanda Gorman actually agreed on the translators to translate her books. And in the Netherlands, there's a young woman, a young white woman, obviously in the Netherlands, who was assigned to translate, and Amanda Gorman approved her. And there was an outcry about why would you have a white woman translate Amanda Gorman
instead of a young black activist, a black woman. Right.
In Spain, there's the same thing because they got a man in Catalonia. So I guess he's translating into Catalonia.
So I think in both cases, I think he was actually asked not to do it.
Right.
And I think in the Netherlands, the woman who was contracted to do actually decided not to do it. So there was so for anybody who doesn't know the story, Amanda Gorman is the poet we've been talking about who did the inauguration speech poem called The Hill We Climb. And of course they're translating it into every language possible because it's a great poem. And so the debate is, do you have to be like the author to be able to sort of understand or transmit what the original poet wanted to say? So of course that brings up all kinds of things like, well, I'm not an ancient Greek either. Does that mean that I can't translate ancient Greek
Homer.
Text if I have that? Right. So, but I was thinking, besides the fact that it's just funny because the backlash is not coming from the poet herself, of course. In fact, that was my first question when we started reading these last week, this came out. And my first question was, what are they not telling me? Because it never actually said in the first articles, it did not mention who was crying about this stuff. Like, who was it? Because it seemed like, would Amanda be crying about this stuff? Like, I think she'd just be grateful that her poem is getting translated into different languages, and that the person be doing it would be a quality, you know, writer. So, I mean, that was my first question, was like, who is it that's making a big deal about it? And it turns out, of course, that the people making a big deal about it are not the person herself, but other people who might be, you know, have comments to say about it. So that made me think too, like, well, of course you feel bad for the translators, but the other thing is like, I've never heard of people choosing translators based on their profile. And so it made me think, you know, translating, I also work as a translator, and I know that it doesn't pay very well. It pays, you know, I mean, especially the longer you go. And I'm thinking, you know, how much would it cost these people just to get three or four different translations of it, given the scope of this thing? You know, how many people are going to read this thing? Lots. Have it translated three or four times by different people and then choose the best one. Mm-hmm. Why are we worried about?
Also, in the past, well, on a certain note, it is good because in the past, you never even knew who the translators were. Nobody really cared who the translator was, unless you're an expert on Proust or something like that. But at least the translators are being recognized, because in the past it really didn't matter, right?
Right, but this is also true. But I remember also that when people would talk about certain texts, they'd say, okay, but I'm going to do this version of it. You know, so why are we worried about having one version? Why can't we have 10 versions of the same one? I guess we have to pay for it. But I still think that the price of a translation is so minimal compared to I think it's good that people are thinking about being aware of different voices and things like that. But it just seems like in this case, there could have been a different type of approach to it. Like even before, could we have avoided this problem by,
Well, as soon as she made her speech the day after, there were translations around in every language of her poem at the inauguration, for example. So,
Sure.
and nobody complained who did that translation, really.
Right.
So, oh, well.
I mean, I think if there are young, you know, if there are young Black activist translators in the different countries and they're going for it, why not? But on the other hand, like, let's look at the quality of the work also. But again, let's be aware. I agree with that, but it's just such a strange situation that I never expected.
Amanda Gore doesn't have anything to do with it.
I don't think she has anything to do with it. And I think it makes her look bad, but I don't think it's her fault. So I feel kind of bad about that. So now, you know, are we going to put this sort of, I mean, the text is so beautiful. Why can't we share it? That I just feel like, well, or it could even be a group of people working on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why not have that, have people consulting? You know, people could say, well, you know, I'm not a translator, but I can help you understand some of the references to this or whatever, you know, but
mm-hmm. Oh, well.
It seems like there's so much at stake and yet there's so little investment in it. That seems to be my, you know, my case. But anyway, so that's one thing we're buzzing about this week. What else is going on this week?
Oh, I'm doing a MOOC this week, or this month, actually. There's an American Spaces update online class, which we started last week, which is really nice. It was nicer when we did it in Vienna, because that's where I was 3 years ago.
Yeah.
But there are 43 people in the class, and we're getting updates on all kinds of things about American Spaces and how to do better virtual programming and how to use the graphics better and all kinds of things. So that's interesting. It's a 30-hour class. But there are a lot of other classes that you can, that people, anybody can take. There are a lot of MOOCs that they're offering that are free from the State Department.
Nice.
Like there's, if you go on the americanenglish.state.gov, there are several MOOCs that are for English language learners. Like there's a media literacy, there's entrepreneurship, there's journalism. And I've seen that more coming up for teaching English as a second language. So there's always something going on. Last year we did that MOOC that you found, the happiness MOOC. Remember?
The happiness MOOC, that was fun. Yeah.
That was during lockdown.
Yeah, I learned a lot from that. I really enjoyed it. I feel like where I'm having some technical difficulty, or you are.
I'm fine.
Mm-hmm. Fine. I can see you. It might be me.
Okay.
Okay, no, I think it's just because we've got two people on, even though we have better internet. I guess it's not perfect yet. But
oh, Ava already started class?
Yeah, that.
She goes to school at
8? Yeah, 8 o'clock she started.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Anna goes at 8:45.
Yeah, she seems pretty, 8:45. Yeah, she seems pretty set. She's pretty psyched. She's one of the people who's like excited to be at home. But, you know, it's funny, but since we're talking about that, I've been asking people, especially students, how they feel about being online. And there's a lot of, especially college age kids, university age kids, who are feeling really isolated, really lonely. So if you know somebody who's in college or university age, high school age, who's studying at home, reach out to them, because I think they're feeling pretty lonely, pretty isolated. Mm-hmm. So we have to do whatever we can to help our young people feel.
Yeah, I've got the high school example.
Wow.
So it's been a year. I think she went back for 2 months. And since last year, it's tough sitting in your room by yourself all day long.
Yeah.
Anyway.
And it's hard to stay engaged, you know, when you have a screen in front of you. So what I've been trying to do, and I think if you're teaching, you know, we kind of look at, there's an article in the New York Times yesterday that talks about teaching online, and it says the loneliness for the teacher, because we don't force, most of us don't force our students to keep the cameras on. And so for different reasons. One of them is just like, you know, if you've got lousy internet, you're going to waste bandwidth just by having your camera on. But what happens is if you're teaching, you know, all that feedback we get and the energy we get from seeing faces kind of disappears. And so one of the things, so there's this really interesting article about it in the New York Times yesterday. If anybody has a subscription to that, it's worth reading to see what the teacher goes through. And I could relate to it. But what I've been kind of doing is with my students is at the end of my classes, I've often been sending them a Google form, you know, just to get some feedback from them. And I found that one of the, you know, I'll just ask them a few questions, like, what are you reading? You know, what's going on with you? You know, what do you remember from the class? So I'll ask them something about what I taught. But again, I'm not putting grades on it. But one of the things I'm asking is just like, you know, how do you feel in this? You know, how's it, how does it make you feel to be at home? Some people don't mind it, but a lot of people are feeling like I miss missing the bus, you know, things like that. Mm-hmm. And what it made, and people thanked me for asking them. So this reminded me of the fact that, you know, let's not take it for granted that some of our young people just need a little bit of contact. Mm-hmm. I know that Denise, when we were on lockdown, you had your buzz chat. We said, give me a call, we can talk, you know, and I think mm-hmm. it is really important to remind people that, you know, we're there, we can connect with you, even if we can't be together.
This is true. We're
still available to have a chat. Yes. Or whatever, because we're also feeling the same.
Yeah. Anybody who's at home and just wants to talk, send us an email with your telephone number and we'll get back to you. Or if you need anything, we'll see what we can do. Okay. So our email is aia.fvg@gmail.com and we'll get back to you. Okay. So are you, you're off to teaching today?
I didn't hear you.
You're teaching today all day.
Yeah. I'm teaching at nine. I'm in.
Okay.
So I got to get ready for that in a minute, but I don't mind teaching online, but it's just like I have days, there's some days where I'm like really several hours in front of the computer. So I feel like I'm more stagnant than I was. I feel like I need one of those walking desks or something or a stationary bike with a desk on it because I've gotten lazy. You know what I mean? Like the more I'm not moving, the lazier I am. So I'm going to try to put my jump rope where I can see it because I wish I had a pair of roller skates because that's what I really like to do. Roller skate around my courtyard when I have a break, but I don't have roller skates and I don't know how to rollerblade. So I'm going to jump rope. I'm going back into time. What did I like when I was younger, when you played for fun? So
we used to roller skate in our basement. It was very dangerous because there were these cement poles in the basement. It was a cement floor, so it was perfect for skating. But we had those skates that you hook over your shoes.
Oh, those were, they could like grow with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, roller skates. And if you had that kind
we had like roller derby in the basement. Roller derby. You had to be careful you didn't run into the washer or dryer and dent it. But
yeah, those were the good old days. And then everybody had to make their scary basements into rec rooms. And then that was it. You know, then you couldn't skate down there anymore.
Right, right.
And then the TVs all went down there. So then it was like scary basement TV. So then you stop watching TV, you know? So
okay.
Anyway, I hope you have a great day and a great
you too. Day. And if I don't talk to you again, happy St. Patrick's Day on Wednesday.
On Wednesday.
Gotta get some beer.
When you have to color it green, right?
Yes,
green.
Yes.
Well,
okay.
Talk to malarkey. Anyway.
All right.
Have a great day.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye, Denise. Bye.